Life for me ain't been no crystal stairs. It's had tax eddies, splinters, and boards torn up, and places with no carpet on the floor bare. But all the time, I've been climbing on and reaching landings and turning corners, and sometimes going in the dark when it ain't been no light. So boy, don't you turn around. Don't you sit down on those steps because you find it kind of hard. Don't you fall now, for I still going, honey. I still climbing. And like me, ain't been no crystal stairs. Brothers, I say that to say this. My name is Terry Andrews. I am from Winston-Salem, North Carolina. I am the youngest of five. I have two brothers and two sisters. I was raised by my mother and father. My mother has a high school education. My father has an eighth grade education. What does that have to do with anything? What does that have to do with the poem that I just recited? Well, with the poem I recited, it reminds me of all the hard work that my mother went through to raise five children while my father worked. Do y'all think that was an easy job for my mother to do? But the one thing about it, no matter what she did, she looked upon my brothers, my sisters, and myself, and always told us, no matter how hard the road may be, just continue to work hard to get to where you want to be in life. To tell you just a little bit about myself, I was thinking about what was I going to speak to you all about. I've spoken to a number of different groups on different age ranges, from elementary school all the way to adults. But considering the platform that I have, we have a wide variety. We have elementary, we have any high schoolers, raise your hand. Any middle school, raise your hand. Any college, raise your hand. Okay. We have any young men in here that have any children? Any children to be on the way? How old are you?
19.
Okay. I ask that question because it helps me decide on what I really want to speak about. A lot of times I sit at home and I write things down. But when I get up to speak, I speak from the heart, even though I know what I've written down. Why do I do that? Because I believe in at least having a platform on what I'm going to talk about, but not always reading from what I write down because I believe in speaking from my heart. It took a lot for me to get to this stage in my life. And it goes back to me being in elementary school. In elementary school, I was not the best student in elementary. As I stated, I have four other siblings, and I'm the youngest. So sometimes being the youngest of five, you sometimes get picked on. You sometimes are viewed as being the mama's child or the daddy's child, things of that nature. But how does that transcend to elementary school? Well, my mom spoiled me growing up. I remember going to elementary school, and I got in trouble all the time. When I got in trouble, especially in first grade, specifically because it reminds me of the time that my mother showed up at the school and I didn't know that she was even coming. But my mom didn't believe that I was doing the things in class that the teacher would call and tell her I was doing it. So the teacher called my mom one time and told her I was in the classroom and I had made this young lady fall. Now, we like to play jokes on people all the time. I know when I was in elementary school, we used to tell people to stand up, and when they stood up, we would remove their chair and just tell them to go ahead and sit down, and they didn't know that their chair was behind, missing from behind, so they'd fall and get hurt. Now, how many of y'all seen that before in school? See? So with me saying that, unless you all know what y'all are doing or have seen, that's nothing new. We've experienced the same thing because I was one of the ones that done it. On that particular day, my mom showed up at the school. I was in the classroom still cutting the food. Never knew that my mom was standing outside the door. I remember the teacher saying, Terry, go outside the door. I went outside the door. Lo and behold, I got greeted by a hand upside my face. My mom took the fire out of me. And when I say she took the fire out of me, yeah, you sound like you done heard something like that before. You smiled. She took the fire out of me. But she took the fire out of me because I was doing something I wasn't supposed to do. Not only that, as you heard the gentleman say, your name precedes itself. When someone mentions a name, it's going to be associated with some sort of action. So in elementary school, just in first grade all the way through sixth grade, I didn't have the best name that teachers wanted to hear. I remember when teachers knew my name to the point that they didn't want me in class when I got promoted to the next grade. And the good thing about me right now is that I'm standing in front of you all, just like so many other brothers in this room, and they can tell you a story about themselves that may resonate in something that you have experienced in your classrooms, or it might be you yourself that I'm talking about. And the one thing that we all have in common is that everyone in this room looks just alike. Just alike. So in elementary school, that first grade slap that came from my mom, it taught me a lesson in the first grade what not to do. Now how long do you think that lesson lasts? It didn't last no more than probably about 2 weeks. I was right back at it. Why was I at it and why was I acting out? And notice I said I grew up with a mother and a father. And I might say some things in here that some of these brothers didn't even know about me. But I don't mind sharing. I grew up with a mother and a father. And I was still one that did done things that I wasn't supposed to do. Mainly because I didn't have a lot of stuff that some of my classmates had. Some of my classmates had nice clothes, nice shoes, and all that good old stuff. Well, again, me being the youngest, I had to wear my brothers and them shoes and pants and shirts because they were handing me down. Some of us may still do that today, but we didn't have a lot of money growing up. Like I said, my father worked, my mother never had to work. Speeding forward to the third grade, I asked the teacher one time, never forget it, could I go use the restroom? And this is how the Marine mentioned earlier, how association with other people can get you in trouble. I remember going to the bathroom in the third grade, and again, I already didn't have a good name throughout the whole school, from every teacher that didn't know me to the principal. So it wasn't hard for them to believe I didn't have anything to do with the name, with what was going on, because I'd done so much before, so it was almost like crying wolf. I asked the teacher, could I use the restroom? The teacher said yes. Went to the restroom. It was another individual, young man, that was in the restroom at the same time. We were from two different classes. We were in the third grade. Our classrooms were right beside each other. And I remember it like it just happened yesterday. We're in the restroom, we playing around. Next thing you know, I go into the stall. While I'm in the stall, I smell something burning. When I smell something burning, I come back out, and there's some toilet tissue and paper towels on fire in the bathroom. He set the fire. So we ran back to class. Someone apparently smelled smoke coming out the bathroom, and my teacher remembered around the same time frame that they smelled the smoke, I was in the bathroom. But what my teacher didn't realize, that there was another person in the bathroom as well, because like I said, that person was not in the same class with me. We just happened to go to the bathroom at the same time. So they go into the bathroom, they investigate and see what the smoke is all about. Come to find out, like I said, it was toilet tissue with paper towels on fire. I got called, I got sent to the office. At this point in time, I said, my mom and dad are going to show up, give me more than just a hand in the face. Because this is the one time I truly knew I didn't do anything wrong, but I had done so much leading up to that. So I'm in the office and I'm telling the principal, I didn't have anything to do with it, I didn't have anything to do with it. The principal, like, yeah, whatever, whoever I have, or whatever, why. And I'm telling him, no, so-and-so. So, needless to say, they call the other person to the office, ask them what was going on. The person said, yeah, I was in the bathroom when Terry was in there. Yeah, and I saw him set the fire. They did a search of me back then. They could search you without having any type of parent's permission. They checked my pockets to see if they found any matches and cigarette lighters, things of that nature. Now, I might have been off the chain back then, but I wasn't crazy enough to bring no matches or anything to school because I knew that was a no-no just by how my mom and dad was. So needless to say, from that experience right there, I got suspended from school for 2 weeks. At that point in time, they felt like that they needed to start labeling me. See, they got these labels nowadays in schools, and it's a little different, probably where you all are compared to how we came through. But back when we came through, if you had a label, they stuck you in a trailer, and that was called special ed. You was in the special ed trailer, you was in the classroom that was off to the side, and that was isolated in that one corner of the school as special ed students. Those were the students that they said they had learning deficiencies or had behavior problems. So they tried to label me as special ed. I started to believe that I had those labels as being special ed because I didn't focus the way I needed to focus on my work because I was so caught up with trying to impress other people by my behavior because I didn't have the clothes and the shoes and the nice things that they had. So my little facade was I can fight and beat everybody. I want to be the jokester of the class. Speeding forward. The fire thing is over and done with. I'm in middle school. That label continued to follow me all the way through middle school. I started losing so-called friends because I was the guy that nobody wanted to be around because I was the one labeled. He started a fire in elementary school. How do I eventually shake this label and I knew what to do? Middle school, things were getting a little worse. A little worse, a little worse. I was acting out a little more, a little more. I was not making good grades, but I wasn't making horribly bad grades. I made the grade enough just to make it to the next grade. Typically, back then, if you made a D, you can go to the next grade with no problem. That's a change nowadays. And I'll tell you why I know that's changed nowadays. So again, you're talking about somebody that has walked through life in elementary school, that's now in middle school, that's still making decisions that are not so wise to where I want to be in life as an adult. Because at that point in time, I still didn't know where I want to be as an adult. I was just enjoying school and didn't want to listen to what an adult would tell me. So middle school, I had my fair share of ups and downs. I would fight all the time. I would get suspended every now and again. I used to get to the point that sometimes I would tell the teacher I was sick, and I'd make like I'd call home because my middle school I went to was in Winston. But my elementary school was in Kernersville, and I lived in between Winston and Kernersville. So in middle school, I got to the point, as I stated, I would tell the teachers I was sick and I needed to go home. Truly, I was just trying to get out of work because I didn't know how to do the work because I didn't apply myself. So at this point in time, I thought I wasn't smart. And I had teachers telling me I was never going to amount to anything. Imagine that, a teacher, an adult, someone that's supposed to be teaching you, telling you, you're never going to amount to anything. Well, lo and behold, I was believing what they were telling me. I was not going to amount to anything. So as I stated, I used to call and say I was sick just to get out of school so I didn't have to do no tests or no work. And I would act like I called home. And I would pass the secretary the phone like, here's my mom. They're coming to pick me up. They want me to stand outside on the sidewalk. And y'all think y'all are smart. I got one play. I get a secretary the phone so my mom can tell the secretary she on my way to pick me up. I was just this smart in terms of street smart. As I hand the secretary the phone, knowing I never called my mama, the secretary say hello. Ain't nobody on the other end. But the secretary believed I done called somebody. So I tell the secretary, I'm going to go outside and wait my mom to come pick me up. My mom never even had a driver's license, so she went driving to pick me up. That's the truth of that. What I would do is go out the front door of the middle school and act like I'm waiting on my mom to come get me. And as soon as I realized it wasn't an adult right there, I walk off. So I have a whole day of doing whatever I want to do. I done got over on the school. My mom and dad wasn't going to know what was going on. But see, they got things in place now. And I'm probably one of the reasons why they got it in place. I can't fool people like that no more. Because who's going to be in a right mind to stand in front of somebody and say, I got my mom on the phone here. She going to tell you, she come to pick me up. And when they get the phone, and they're like, hello, Ms. Andrews? Hello, Ms. Andrews? And you sit there smiling. Little horns coming up. Yeah, I got this one. And I say, what's wrong? And you know, you call back. And see, one thing I knew about my mom, back then we had those old phones. It didn't have no two-way. When you took the phone off the hook, you would get a busy signal. So when the secretary tried to call back, the phone was busy. I got to the point that I was that smart to try to outfox them. But it came back on me. It might have not came back that day. But by the time I got to the eighth grade, that trick ran out. Because my mom came to pick me up one day and I didn't know she was coming. I was gone. Because I had pulled the trick. But they talked about, well, we called. And you know, you said, in their mind, they thought they done really spoke to her. Because they done believed it so much. They believed it so much. But see, that's me playing jokes on people at a young age that some of you may have experienced. But see, what we have to understand is, how is that going to help you as you become older? Now, I've touched on one critical point, was that I felt like I was not smart or intelligent because I believe what somebody told me, because my behavior and my name associated with someone that you didn't want to have in your class. I'm in high school now. We're out of middle school. I'm in high school. Once I got to high school, I thought I was cool then. See the cuts y'all got right now? I call those reruns. Why I call them reruns? Because it's just duplicating what we've already done. We've had the flat tops, the slopes, the waves, all that. I had the Kwame. Kwame was the dot. See, you got the little dot and all that going on. Mm-hmm. I had all that coming through high school, but now I'm bald, so watch out. You know, I've had all that coming through high school as well. So again, just going back to show you that what y'all are going through, we've already been there. So in high school, like I said, I'm in high school now, and I'm enjoying high school because you get a little more freedom. You see a lot of girls. Now you want to know who you're going to match. You know, look at Shorty right there. She a dime piece. Or she a thot. Or whatever. You know what I'm saying? See, y'all got all these little slangs going on now. You know? Oh, wow. You know, all this, that, and the third. But the reality was, I started coming into myself and started to realize that nobody's going to walk behind me to go to class in the 9th, 10th, 11th grade. When girls were starting to like me, I said, well, getting in trouble wasn't a good thing for me. But just keep in mind, in elementary school, I still had that label that he done started to fight. See, I ain't forgot about that because that still followed me all the way to high school. All the way to high school, it still followed me. And I'm genuinely knowing that I didn't even do it. So, high school, I'm doing my thing. I'm playing football. I started driving a school bus in high school as a senior. I was the mascot, believe it or not, one year in high school. Yeah, Raymond Brothers, brother, don't you? I was the mascot one year in high school. In high school, I started to understand that if I didn't listen and surround myself by a certain population, I started to believe at that point in time that I could do the homework because I thought the work was a little more easier for me then. So by my senior year, the first time in my life, I made honor roll. Never made honor roll from elementary school all the way to high school until my 12th grade year. In the 12th grade, that's when it started clicking to me that the teachers that said I was never going to amount to anything, I stopped believing that and took on what I wanted to be in high school in the 12th grade. See, in the 12th grade, some of you may remember this. You could drive school bus in high school back then. I was the last student driver in Forsyth County here in Winston-Salem. What does that mean? They stopped allowing students to drive school buses in high school. And the year that they stopped it, I was the last student to ever get a bus as a student in high school and drive. I was getting a paycheck. I didn't have to worry about my mom and dad buying me anything because we didn't have the best of everything in the world, but I found a way to start saying, how am I going to be successful? So when I started seeing myself driving a school bus, I'm getting a paycheck like I'm a grown man, and I went out and bought my first brand new car off the showroom floor in high school. Never forget it. It was a Mitsubishi Eclipse. Bought it off Lynx Road. I walk in as a senior in high school, got a brand new car on my own. My dad told me off when I got home because I still lived at home with my mother and father. I didn't check in with them. I didn't ask them that. By that time, I was trying to do the right thing, but still, I made a grown man decision, and I'm just a senior in high school. When we got past that, I got to keep the car because it was my car. But they taught me something along the way. It taught me that as long as I'm up under my parents' roof, I still got to follow rules and regulations. It taught me that if I have a job, I got to learn to budget and do things the right way and not go out there and just spend just because I had money. In high school, again, driving that school bus, I'm in my senior year. I done played football. Actually, when I was at East Forsyth, I lettered 3 years. I'm going to say something that a lot of people don't know. Brother Gordon may not know this, but he can go back and look at the history book. I set the longest kickoff return for a touchdown at Carver when we played Carver. You know, again, that's something I felt good about because I was one that people said that was not going to be successful. I did 4 years of high school ROTC. thinking that when I was going to graduate from high school, I was going to go into the military. So as I stated, I found a way to change some of the behaviors, and I eventually phased out those teachers that said I was not going to amount to anything based off feeling good about myself and rebuilding my name. Rebuilding my name. And rebuilding your name, once it becomes seen in a negative way, is very, 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 very hard. From a young person all the way into adulthood, it takes a lot to do. So I graduated from high school. I think I'm going into the Marines, to be honest with you. I chose between going to the Marines, I had a scholarship to play football at Lee's McRae Junior College, or just continue to work. I went on my high school college visit to the college. I didn't like the university, well, the college was a junior college, I didn't like it, so I chose not to go to college at that point in time. With the military, like I said, I started to believe that I was smart, but I was still learning how to understand some things in terms of processing because I never applied myself early. So as in terms of the ASVAB, I can never pass the ASVAB. That's true if you know, because I never applied myself. You just can't go take it and think you're going to pass it just like that. It takes a lot to apply yourself to do certain things. But if you don't start out early, it just makes it that much more harder. So that left one alternative for me. No college, no military. I was already driving a school bus, so I stayed driving the school bus once I graduated. I remember that the transportation supervisors here in Winston-Salem would give me the worst bus in the whole county. Y'all, how many people have drove a bus before? Anybody? How many people seen kids going down the road just standing up on the bus and be like, I wouldn't drive that bus for nobody because the kids just off the chain. They gave me the bus with the worst kids in the whole county. And no one would believe that anybody could drive this bus and control the bus because the students on the bus ran the bus driver off every time. Well, lo and behold, they met the right one. They didn't run me off. They didn't run me off by no means. Because I had the same attitudes that they thought they had. The only difference is, I realized I was a little more crazy than them. They thought he was crazy. See, that's reality. This is life. There's a difference in reality and professionalism. I can talk to you about professionalism all day long, but right now I'm talking to you about reality and life. So my name started getting known throughout Forsyth County that if you had a child or a bus full of students that wouldn't listen, give it to Terry Andrews, see what he can do. My name started getting known in a good way to be able to control behaviors on the bus so we can get everybody to the school safely. Principals started taking notice, and that's leading me into my professional career to where I am now. Principals started taking notice of how does this bus keep coming up on this school premises, and these kids sitting there like somebody done zapped them. We remember 6 months ago, this bus come in and it's rocking left and right. Ned's coming in, and it's the quietest thing around. So I remember there was a young girl on one of the buses. She was eating some candy, and she got choked. And we just had got to the school, Pine Grove Elementary, never forget in the Kernsville. The administrator, which was the principal and the teachers, they didn't know what to do. They panicked. Luckily, I worked for the Y in the summertime, and I was CPR certified. That was the first real acknowledgement I got from a person from the school system to tell me that I was a good person. They actually validated the direction that I was trying to go in. I performed a Heimlich maneuver on the young lady, and the candy lodged out. And so they wrote a letter to the transportation department to let them know. Then the principal started asking me, was I interested in becoming a teacher's assistant in the classroom? So I'm like, wow, this is pretty cool. Me in the classroom, the same place that told me I wasn't going to mount anything. Bingo, this is cool. This is cool. It's amazing how something that tries to tear you down later on in life, you get reconnected with it. So I said, let me take this challenge. I ended up at a school that was called Petrie Middle School. That was the middle school that they put all behavior problems students at throughout the whole county. And then not only was I in that school, I was in the worst of the worst classrooms. It was called labels again, BED, behaviorally emotionally disturbed. Meaning that every student in this classroom had behaviorally emotionally disturbed problems, that they were not teachable, You couldn't talk to them, and they were off the chain. Here I go again. I'm in this classroom with the same ones that's supposed to be off the chain, and I'm a teacher assistant. Well, me and my partner at that time, his name was David Westbrook. He was the lead teacher. We accomplished a lot in that classroom, and it led me to have one of the greatest opportunities that I never thought that I would be able to have. I became a principal of alternative day school. Now imagine me going from being a teacher assistant, don't have a college degree, to being a principal of alternative day school. Now how does that happen? Where does that happen at? Don't you supposed to have a college degree to be a principal or administrator? Well, what people don't know, the criteria has changed now, but back then, if you were a alternative day school, all you had to do was have so many certifications and follow certain education guidelines throughout the state of North Carolina. So that qualified me to be the principal of alternative day school, and that school at that time was called Vision's Work Alternative Day. And that school was the school at Forsyth County that they sent every student that was suspended, long term or short term, from any middle school in Winston-Salem to this particular school. And if you were on probation, you were there. So I dealt heavily within the court system. So I remember that same teacher that told me that I was never going to amount to anything. She was still a teacher at that time. I was a principal of alternative day school at the age of probably 24. That's very young. At age 24, I remember that some students got sent over to this one particular school. So we had to do what we call re-entry back into the regular school setting. We re-entered these students back into the regular school setting, and this particular school I went over to take the students back to, this teacher was still in education. And this was one of her students. And lo and behold, our paths crossed again. And we were talking about, how many of you ever heard about IEP? Okay, IEP. So we were going over an IEP. IEP is pretty much a work plan, individual work plan for students that need certain type of modifications to get them right in class or not. So me and this teacher, you know, we was going over everything, and the teacher said, your name sounds so familiar. Me, I already knew she was. But there again, your name will. But she would never thought about this in that direction. And I said, yes. She said, are you from here? I said, yes. I said, no. Didn't you used to teach school at Cash Elementary School? She said, yes. Yes, I did. I said, yeah, I was in your class. Her face just dropped. It literally dropped, honestly. Because I was the person that was not supposed to be successful. And here she is meeting with Mr. Andrews, not Terry Andrews. Mr. Andrews. So, long story short, our conversation was pretty much short after we did the business that needed to be taken care of, but I left there with my head held high because somebody from my childhood experience had the opportunity to see me in a different light. In a different light. Again, your name follows you. Your name follows you. So with that being said, with me being a principal of an alternative day school, and I don't want to run out of time because I can go on and on, but I'm just trying to walk you up to where I am today from a young age to a college age, to an adult age individual. I've dealt with the court system for a number of years. I've dealt with, like I said, being a principal of alternative day school. I dealt with being a director of a group home, which is out of place placement for those individuals that are not suitable to live at home with their parents. Currently, before I get to current, I had everything that I wanted working in the right direction, but a college degree. But a college degree. My mother's from a background where there are heavy educators throughout Forsyth County. My uncle was a first black probation officer, North Carolina, Forsyth County, Harold B. Ferguson. I remember many days spending time in his offices as a probation officer he was then, and always tried to instill in me the positive things to do in life. But then one day, I woke up, and I was dating somebody, and we ended up getting pregnant. I said there was something missing in my life. I don't want my child to be born, and daddy does not have a college degree. That's what I said. Because I always said I wanted to go to college. I just woke up one day and I went to college. Well, I went to apply.
and I ended up getting enrolled at Winston State. So again, me being out of school for a number of years, thinking that I was not going to be successful, now I'm taking on education again. Concentration of Public Administration, graduated with honors, which again, that was a huge feat for me. Graduated with honors from college as an adult, feeling good and focused, becoming the president of the alumni chapter at Winston State University. I'm telling you about where I am now, because somebody told me I would never be successful and I wouldn't make it. Currently, I work as a child support enforcement agent, and my job, well, let me just ask this, because I know I'm going to see some hands. How many people heard of child support before? Okay. And I ask that because a lot of times people may say, I heard of it. Do you know what child support is? Yes. What is child support? Tell me.
So, financial mom kid for the child.
For the child. Okay, anybody else? What do you think child support is? You're on the path. Both of you on the path. Go ahead. Okay, anybody else? You're absolutely right. There's a certain amount of money that one parent is designated to have to pay to another parent to take care of a child if those two people do not live together. Now, I get to that point. I get to that point. Because you know what I like? Interaction. You don't know unless you ask. And it's important that I mention child support because I can tell you how it's determined. I can tell you who's responsible and who's not responsible. But the one big thing that people believe is that a lot of men are the ones that always have to pay child support. And that's not the case. There's a lot of women that pay child support as well. And how that is determined? Typically, that's determined by who you live with. So if you do not live with both your mother and father, meaning they live in two different houses, the person that you live with, you go to school from, their house, typically, in that particular scenario, that's the person that's going to get the child support. They don't have to pay. The other person that doesn't live there and doesn't, that you don't live with, they the ones that have to pay. Now, how much they have to pay, it depends on if they have a job and how much they make. Now, you want me to tell you the fun part about my job? I'm go ahead before I tell you this. Go ahead. And that's a different process. We have something in place that if you visit them the same amount of time, sometimes neither person has to pay. Or one person may have to and the other one may not. So that's a different process. But the part that we're accustomed to seeing is when the parents don't split equal time. Now, the fun part about my job, and some people think it's crazy, what do you think I do? I say I do child support enforcement. What do you actually think I do? Well, it's part of it. Be right. Go ahead. That is absolutely right also. But I'm going to tell you the fun part about my job. The fun part about my job is to bring you in court and have you locked up. And why do I say that's the fun part of my job? Because I personally believe that any person that does not want to take care of their child and they truly have the ability to do so and just neglects the child, they need to be held accountable. Notice I said neglect the child. We have all kinds of circumstances that can prevent, you know, people from paying the child support. And we do assess that appropriately. But if you just flat out neglect responsibilities, I do not have a soft spot in my heart. So part of my job requires me to stand up in front of the judge and present my case. And my case is all about how much you paid, how much you didn't pay, how many times you paid, when was the last time you paid. And I take pride in doing that. Now, what I like to also do is help people. It's about communication too. As well as I like to make sure that every youth is taken care of, I still have a part of me that want to make sure that if there's a part of an individual that truly can't pay for child support, that I assist them in having the right avenues to be able to obtain a job, counseling, or anything of that nature. So here I am today. I'm in a situation in terms of job that I really like. In terms of you all being knights, I'm a knight as well. Some of you was here when I went through the initiation. So me being a part of this organization is nothing new. I'm a knight. I am a master mason. As you heard in the introduction, my new title is District Deputy Grand Master. That's neither here nor there, because at the end of the day, what it boils down to me is this. I'm somebody just like these other brothers and men that you see sitting around here. I'm somebody that cares enough to take enough time out to come and teach you. If you are experiencing some things in your life and you think that other people have not experienced it, I'm telling you that I'm standing in front of you being successful. Not as successful as I want to be, because I have room to continue to grow, but I'm being successful starting from the ground when someone didn't believe in me, and I believe that name that followed me. I'm an adult. This is 2015. I was approached probably back in 2011, about the same thing that I talked about. That's the guy that set the fire in the bathroom. I had enough of it, and I had to confront the people about it. And what I didn't want to do was throw the person name out there, because all they knew was what they heard. But I pulled them to the side, and I told them very kindly, I said, let me tell you this, I'm an adult, just like you are. I said, I don't know what you know or what you heard. But what I do know is that I'm the one person that will tell you the truth and keep it real with you. I've lived with this for a long time, and I'm going to get it off my chest because I'm tired of you, because this person has said it numerous times as an adult, accusing me of something I didn't do when you were not there. I said, let me tell you what the real story is, and it may be hard for you to believe, but I'm not that person that did what they said I did. But it's hard as a youth for people to believe you when you've done so many things. This person that continuously, at that point in time, not understand that it wasn't me, finally got the message, it wasn't me. And what made them feel even more, made them feel bad. I use that for lack of other words. What made them feel even bad about me confronting them about that situation, I confronted them with respect, and I knew that they wasn't successful in life. They weren't successful in life, but they were doing the things I was doing when I was younger as an adult. See, we switch places. But there again, you all may be going through some things. You all may see us stand up in front of you and talk to you about some things. But how often do people come in looking like us, telling you that we have been through some of the same things that you've gone through? I'm going to say this last little bit, and I'm going to let you ask questions, and I'm going to be done. As you think about where you want to be, where you are now, tomorrow, 5, 10 years from now, keep in mind, think about the label you want to follow your name. But more importantly, in terms of my job, not only dealing with child support enforcement, I've dealt with juvenile probation as well. More importantly, understand this. You do not want to be tied up in the system. What is the system? The court system. Anything from a criminal violation to child support. Because one of the common things that I get in my arena of child support is this. I don't need the system to tell me what to do. Well, unfortunately, the system has to tell you what to do, whether you like it or not, because you allow the system to be a part of your life by not doing the appropriate things. Do not allow the system to determine your life. Determine your life without people telling you. Because, like I said, what I enjoy about my job is standing up in court, presenting my cases, and I have yet to lose a case in court. Because I only take you to court when I know I'm going to win. There's no need for me to take you to court if I'm going to lose. So, long story short, think about what we're doing. Think about the adults that you meet. A lot of times you don't have to say anything. Just watch their actions and decide, is that where you want to be as an adult? Does anyone have any questions for me?
I do. How long was that touchdown again?
You tell me how many yards it take from the back of the end zone to the end zone.
Do you need some references?
Maurice Brown. I'll ask them all.
I believe it.
But you were not on the football field back when I was there, okay?
Yeah, I was already gone.
But anyway, again, I appreciate coming in and talking to you. I don't call you children. I call you young men. I call you young adults. I call you somebody that look like me, even though we might not have the same hairstyle. We might not wear the same clothes. We might not live in the same household. But one thing we have the same struggles. So I appreciate your time. And if you ever see me, talk to me. I'm approachable. No question is a dumb question. If a person tell you it's a dumb question, you might have asked the question to make it sound dumb, but if you're sincere in what you're asking, then you should get an answer. Thank you. Somewhat successful or not. But my mother passed away in 2012. The one thing my mom told me was that she would love to live long enough for us to have an African-American president. And when she said that statement, a lot of us heard statements like that before. We want to live long enough to see if there will ever be an African-American president. I'm going to tell you, if my mom was here right now to tell you, she'd probably break down and start crying. Not only did she lived long enough to see an African-American president, she lived long enough for her son to take a picture with President Barack Obama and have it sitting in her house. And that's probably one of the most proudest moments of her life when she saw me in the picture with Barack Obama. And there's another guy that you all may not know of, but his name is John Hope Franklin. He's the first African-American that Duke University named a building off of. And he's heavily known for Emancipation Proclamation. They may be a little bit over your head. But what I'm saying is that, you know, Barack Obama had a dream. He achieved that dream. Some of us have, and you all are here to see that there has been an African-American president. But I can honestly say that's what y'all see. But from where I sit, for me being able to sit right there, shake his hand, and sit beside somebody that President Barack Obama looked up to was a lot to me and my mother. So again, if there's anybody you have high aspirations of meeting, don't ever think that that is unreachable as well. But I just want to put that out there. If you think it, you can achieve it.
That's unique, bro.
I'm looking at the time. Your time?
You go ahead.
Basically, what transpired was I had a friend whose mother worked on President Barack Obama's campaign. And he and I are very, very close. And the opportunity presented itself, and he called me. And I said, sure. Why not?
You have
his number? No, I don't have his number. Not President Barack Obama, no, I don't have his number. But my friend's mother is very close with him. Now, she may have his personal number, but I'm sure she don't have the White House number. Yeah, but I just wanted to share that with you because that's a part of history. That's a part of history. And anytime you can seize the moment to be a part of history, take that opportunity and see.
Junior, nice good evening.
Good evening.
Yeah, just want to say, just kind of picking at those few things that Andrew's saying, that is a phenomenal story, and I was truly inspired by it. I'm quite sure a lot of you gentlemen have been. But just kind of want to piggyback on a few things that he was saying that kind of resonated with me, that my mother has been telling me growing up. She said, never let the opinions of other people become the opinion of yourself. She said, because people gonna call you all kinds of things, but you don't have to believe that's what you are. You know, trust and know who you are and believe in yourself. And that's pretty much what Brother Andrews was saying, that if you believe in yourself, that's all that matters. Because somebody else might not think that you can do X, Y, and Z, but if you believe you can do it, you know, then you can do it. And that's just like, that's what Brother Andrews was saying, that he started to believe that he could. He started thinking that he could. And he did it when he started to believe that he could do it. And that dispelled all the other stuff that those other teachers and whoever else was saying about him. He started to believe that he could do it. So if you believe that you can, that's all that matters. And we was talking about President Barack Obama. You know, we all were saying, you know, we believe, we think, we hope that we get to see a black president. And we actually got to see him re-elected to go into the White House. And I didn't get to meet President Obama, but I did get to meet John Franklin when I was a seminary student at Duke. And I will never forget something he said to me before he died. I got invited to his birthday party. And it was me and a bunch of other students at Duke Seminary. And we were sitting around, and at the end, and John Franklin is a historian, a widely world-renowned historian. And at the end of the party, I asked him, I said, do you ever think, and this is back in the fall of 1999, I asked him at that birthday party, I said, do you ever think that there will be a black president? He looked at me, he said, yes, when you become great. I never got that. And then here you are, got in a picture with Barack Obama and John Franklin. So all of that came to fruition. So and that's how God works. But guys, just believe in yourself and you can do anything.
All right.